Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Blake and Sal Show with Mark. For over 10 years, dominating the podcast world. Now sit back, relax, and get ready to have some fun. Let's welcome your hosts, Blake, Sal, and Mark.
Beatlemania is putting the dust. London calling, see we ain't got no swing except for the rain and the crunch of thing. The ice is coming, the sun's zooming in.
Hello and welcome to the Blake and Sal Show with Mark, episode number 522, live on Facebook and on YouTube. This is going to be an interesting show because everyone's jumping in as we go here. So, first of all, Sal's not here today. He is taking a mental health day, so he was not going to be here for the show today. But let's bring on who we have. The main mental Mark, how you doing?
Doing well, as best as I can be.
Yeah, it's been a clusterfuck to start the show today, but it's what it is.
Hey, we work on the fly.
Yeah, you can't ask for better. So,
what's echoing in here?
Yeah, all kinds of problems here.
There we go. All right. So let's actually, first of all, the opening song was actually Sal's selection. It is on the class London Calling. Figured I'd keep the opening for him. What the hell? So a little behind the scenes, we actually just recorded next week's show right before we did this. So I literally just finished editing it and then came on to do the live show. So that's just a little behind the scenes of what's going on here today. So a little scrambly right now. So let's actually bring on our guest, first of all, as the person just banged his microphone on the table for some reason, which is annoying. So don't do that. Let's not bring on our first guest who is sitting next to me, who gets a full entrance because I promised him last show I would do this for him. Cristian, how you doing?
Hello, everybody.
Yes, he's sitting next to me. I brought that out for the con a couple years ago, and he's still like, "What the hell? How did you get that video? How did you get that video?" So
didn't expect.
Okay, bruv.
What's going on? Our other guest who's like, "Wow, these things have changed a lot since I was here." Funny is he's like something, and then I follow the bottom screen. Here's all I see is he's on the bottom, but you can see it on the screen. From the PW Tour, it's Rich. And how you doing?
Pretty good. I'm glad that I'm not the cause of the chaos, even though I was almost the cause of the chaos.
No, don't worry about that. There is no worries. It's just you know how this show is sometimes. Things get a little chaotic here. This is how it always works. You know, it's just nothing new. Nothing new here at all. So before we continue on, let's quickly do this. Pick up Mandy's book. I know I am available at all books. Read my book at Yeah, I cannot talk today. I'm at Barnes & Noble and Orange Publishing, now in English and in Spanish.
Them kids. Fuck them kids.
So, before we get into anything, Rich, why don't you get your plugs out of the way in case you have to appear on us for whatever reason?
All right, so I would say, oh, wow, you got them all there. So over on the Torch side of things, I do the Everything Universe. So Everything with Rich Fann, with Wade Keller, our editor-publisher. I also do the Everything Mailback with Josh Mustachio. And then I also do the daily cast of The Deep Dive with myself, either solo or with Will Cooling. And then over on the post-wrestling side of things, I do MCU Later, a Marvel Cinematic Universe movie podcast where we're currently doing MCU Hater because we're looking at the movies I cannot stand. But thank you very much. And I won't need to leave because my wife decided to stay and play kickball with the hockey team. So I'm all yours.
Oh, that works. Whoa. That works. I have to ask because if they're going to ask, what movie are you up to right now do you hate the most?
Okay, so typically I wasn't going to be in the business of doing it, but Wei Ting over at Post threw the challenge at us. And so the first movie we did with Cam Hawkins, formerly of The Torch, currently of The Ringer in Complex, we did X-Men Apocalypse, a movie in which a man whose mutant power of flight prevented him from dying in a plane crash. Just work that through your head. Just...
The mind boggles.
We're just like, what the hell? What's going on with the show now?
I like it. No, you said you had the soundboard. I was ready from last time.
All right.
There you go.
That being said, let's get into things. We have a lot of things going on here today, so let's do this.
And now, let's get into the crazy world of professional wrestling.
So, as CJ's doing something, he just went off the screen. So let's actually get right into something. We have a few things to talk about here. We're not going to get into a whole shit ton of news, but that's not what we do here. We have some important stuff we have to get to. First things first, we have the G1. We've been talking about this for weeks. I did get to see the finish of the G1 while I was in New York City last week. So that was a lot of fun. I got to admit, I said this on the last show, I was really, really had fun with the G1 this year. Rich, I know you won't have been following with the Torch, covering it. Your thoughts on the G1? And Zack Sabre Jr. winning the G1, and then not even taking his title match at Wrestle Kingdom. He's doing it elsewhere. So, Rich, why don't you explain that?
Yeah, so starting with the G1 itself, I thought it was a really good start-to-finish G1, but not for the reasons you usually would think, because typically G1s are going to be super action-packed, super awesome, super wonderful. I think this was a good learning year for New Japan. They had a lot of young guys. They had a lot of guys from other promotions. A guy like Konosuke Takeshita stepped up and kind of showed out. And then you have Zack, the prince that was promised, if you will. The guy who you kind of thought always had a chance, and now he has that chance to be the top guy. I always love when I come on this show, one, because of the fun family time y'all bring, but also because of the music of a man who sadly is entering the end of his road. Tetsuya Naito, between injuries and his... he took what was... I think we talked about this before when I came on last time. He got the last eye surgery the doctor could legally give him to correct his vision issues before his last title reign. And so now between his vision, his knees, and the rest of his body is starting to shut down. And so moving it up to October is as much for the health of Tetsuya Naito as it is to change things up and allow Zack Sabre a potential chance to kind of spruce up the top of the heavyweight division for the men.
Do we know if Naito is going to have any more surgeries coming up, or is this going to be an after thing when he decides to hang it up?
That's the sad thing, Mark. It was, from what I understood and from what he said for years, the doctor said he could only operate on that eye, and that's why he does that, because of injury he received, and then people would do that to him in Mexico to be racist, but then he turned it on them. He was allowed to do three of those surgeries, and the third surgery, he was always going to wait until after he retired, and he did it back in last January. And so he can't get that operated on anymore. So any sort of degeneration from wrestling, from hits to the head that happens after, are going to just be inoperable. Now with the knees, he could get those cleaned up. He may need them replaced. That's probably going to be the thing that, much like Kijimuto, all of those knee-based moves are kind of catching up to him, and he may just need to call it a career.
I don't know. Do I see him as a trainer in New Japan or something where he's looking for talent to basically bring into the organization?
I think it'll depend on his relationship with the front office. A lot of what he's done as a gimmick is really a reflection of who he is. So for Naito, if he could just go watch baseball the rest of his life for his hometown team, he'd do that. But if they wanted him to be in the office in some capacity, I think there would be a level outside of what he's done already. Like sometimes he has guys he's trained and done in the dojo and et cetera. But I think if they wanted more than that out of him, there would need to be a fundamental shift from Bushiroad in terms of kind of the respect shown and also the level of responsibility he was given.
Oh, there you go. I actually was thinking, so DSJ has decided he's not going to get his title shot at Wrestle Kingdom. Why don't explain that one to people? That was the confusing one to be watching it live. Rich.
Yeah, so him saying it live, people were just very like, wait, what? We're going to October 14th instead of January 4th? But the more you think about it, it makes sense. It allows him to have a shot at going into the January 4th show. Because remember, AEW is going to be on the next night with, I can't remember. It's not Wrestle Dynasty, but it's...
Is it Wrestle Dream? I'm looking at it right now. I think it is
Wrestle, it's Wrestle Dynasty. My brain like didn't trust itself.
Wrestle Dream is in October.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah, so Wrestle Dynasty that next night. If you have Zach go up against either a Tsuji or a Yumura or someone that's like a youngish guy, or even, heck, I would say if you give him a shot, Konosuke Takeshita versus him.
Oh, geez, that would be amazing.
Oh, yes. Schmidt.
I mean, listen, I want a wife swap situation where, like, they've already taken Kenny Omega, they've taken Will Ospreay, they've taken Okada. Let Takeshita chill out in New Japan for a couple of months. Like, you... let him hang out there for a few months. It'll be fine.
I will admit that Christian surprised the hell out of me in this tournament. Like, that was a hell of a showing all the way through. I know Christian kept asking me, how's he doing? How's he doing? And I'm like, he's looking fucking fantastic. Like, yeah. He really is. So
I think putting him in New Japan is going to make him a little bit more seasoned, that if he would go to another organization, he'd have everything from New Japan plus. So...
let's throw it out there. People are coming in and out of the live stream. If you want to comment, please comment in the YouTube or Facebook comments. We'll put it up on the stream just to throw it up there. I know people are jumping in and out. I've been seeing it. So if you're seeing coming in, you want to say something, jump into the comments. I'll put them on the stream.
I'd be the first one to admit I never thought that Zack Sabre Jr. would win it. I never thought.
I didn't have him winning going in, but then as the story continued, I'm like, okay, that makes sense. That makes perfect sense, what they're doing.
I mean, I get it. You know, President Tanahashi, he's throwing his eggs all in on Zack Sabre Jr., and let's see if he's able to carry the organization.
There was last time we were here, we were talking about the point that Tanahashi made in that press conference. Here we are with the G1, where it's like, oh, wow, he did change a lot. So
let's see where it goes. I mean, more power to him, and the sky's the limit with him, because he's one of these type of wrestlers that can be versatile, you know, not just Matt technician and ground. You know, if you want to brawl, he can brawl. He can change things up. And that's the thing about him, is that he's versatile. And that's the selling point of Zack Sabre Jr.
All right, let's move on. One other thing before we get to AEW stuff. You got to bring it up. It happened at NXT.
Say his name and he appears.
Joe Hendry is going to be facing Ethan Page, a TNA contractor wrestler. He's going to be facing in the NXT champion at No Mercy on September 1st. When this match was announced, I'm like, okay, the only reason it makes sense is Joe Hendry winning. That makes sense. And because everyone else is in a storyline or in a rivalry, he's the only one that just kind of here. And here we are. I know Christian is the only one here that doesn't seem to believe in Joe Hendry. So your thoughts on Joe Hendry getting a title shot here?
I don't really know what to say, but anyways, it's going to be a good match, though.
You think so?
It is going to be a good match, but okay. Ethan Page better win.
Say his name and he appears.
So, Rich, your thoughts on this matchup happened in numbers. We're not going to be here next week, so I wanted to make sure I brought it up here.
I think this match is awesome. I think Christian may be mad at me in my debut being a guest with the Cristian as a guest, as one of the co-hosts, but the way TNA contracts are built or not built allows for people to show up in a lot of places. And in the case of Joe Hendry, from what I understand, and I can't say this with veracity, his contract was kind of open, kind of like a relationship. And so I believe he is an NXT contracted wrestler that they just haven't told us yet, a la back in the day when Al Snow was in ECW. And we forgot, oh, wait, he was that guy on WWE television a couple of months ago.
That is pretty funny. That is pretty funny. Do you expect him to win the title, Rich?
Yes, I think he will. And I think he's going to be the champion going into the CW era, if you will.
Wow. Wow. I think I would never have saw that one coming at any level. Dad, your thoughts?
I got to echo Rich on this one because right now, Joe Hendry is a hot commodity. And if WWE and NXT don't take advantage of the situation, they're going to kick themselves in the butts later because somebody, possibly AEW, will scoop him up because they know how hot he is. If you don't jump on this right now, you're losing out. And I think the best thing for NXT forward coming to the CW would be to put the belt on Joe Hendry and then let him have feuds with other top wrestlers. And I can see like the Don, Oba Femi, someone from Gallus. You know, you can have multiple opponents for him and it would work out.
So, quick story. This has nothing to do with TV, but I want to tell this story because I won't have another opportunity not to do it. So, right before we went on vacation, we had a family game of Cards Against Humanity.
Oh, no.
And so, what happened was, we're all in like a Joe Hendry mood and it pisses off Cristian and it's fun. So, what happened here? Mandy decided we have these cards that are like you can write in stuff, you can do whatever you want. So Mandy decided to do this and make a Joe Hendry card for the game.
I'm pissed.
And I
the look on her face.
She's absolutely in love with the guy, so like it works out perfectly here.
He appears.
So what happened here? I put this up on my Instagram story, just you know, for fun, for funsies, nothing major. And I always tag him and stuff. We talk about him, and he never gets a reaction. Well, what did I expect him to actually like my story?
Hey!
So there you go. I didn't expect that. That was a cool
spot. We got one more follower.
We believe. We believe.
Say his name, and he appears.
All right, we'll move on.
Osprey. I'm sorry, it's the wrong guy.
Osprey. Let's move on to AEW. So before we get to the pay-per-view this weekend, the big news that came out, next year's All In is going to be in Texas. It's going to be at the Globe Life Field in Texas. It's the Texas Ranger Stadium, I believe. It's going to be July 12th. It's weird that they're moving into July. I think they're only going to do it this weekend because it's some holiday.
Hopefully it's not a big card.
But
everything's bigger in Texas.
Bring it down. You're closer to it out. But so we have... Texas, I'll make your joke.
Hopefully it's not a big card because everything's bigger in Texas.
Wow. One would think I'd be ready to go with the awkward sound effect.
There you go.
Anyway, I just want to throw that out there. This is an interesting move. To do it in July, to do All In in Texas, not do it in London. Very interesting. Rich, any thoughts?
I think it makes sense for a couple of reasons. One, with about 53,000 people at the Wembley Stadium event this weekend, that's a long ways away from 85 or 83 or whatever the official number is Tony threw out. But as someone mentioned during the conference call today, 50,000 plus both years in a row on a bank holiday weekend with football back and soccer for us here in the States, that is still ridiculously awesome. But given all of the stuff you have to pay to get Wembley, etc., coupled with them just now finishing up, Craven Cottage updates, which is the home stadium for Fulham, which Tony and his family owns. It makes sense to go back to London because he said London, not back to Wembley in 2026, which they might just go to Craven Cottage if they can get that date, which as the owner, I'm sure he can, as long as Fulham isn't playing that night. But I'm sure he could work with the EPL and get that moved around, except for the fact, oh, the EPL is in bed with WWE now. That's awkward. So, yeah, just like with the NFL, where you have 31 teams that get title belts and one that doesn't mysteriously, you have 19 EPL clubs that get belts, and also one of them now is the official WWE 2K sponsored team, and one will not partake in that. So it's a lot of massaging, but I think it makes sense for them to be in Texas.
It's so
the other thing that I'm hearing why Texas too is, and I've heard back and forth that this may be it for Dustin Rhodes, for him to hang up his boots, to speak. Right now, he's the ROH trio champion with Von Erich.
And the tag team champion with Sammy Guevara.
Right. So, for some reason. And he's talked about that it's getting a little bit more rough and hard. So, I mean, maybe this is... That's what she says, yeah.
I hate you being to it.
So, maybe this is the way of sending Dustin out on a high note.
I don't know. Well, let's move on to this Sunday, on the day after this show airs, we have All In London, number 2. I'm almost sad Sal's not here, because I don't know who would love this damn song. It's Bush Machine Head, of course. That is the anthem again for All In this year. I remember last year, they didn't tell us what the anthem was. All of a sudden, they start playing the song, and Sal freaked out during the pre-show. I'm like, oh my God! He was so happy. I really was hoping he was going to be here for that. So, this year, but he's not here, unfortunately. We have a very packed card. A very, very packed card. Looks like usual for a pay-per-view, but... as per always, usually when recording this on Wednesday, I go and say, we have one more Dynamite and Collision, and there'll probably be 27 more matches added before we get to the show. Well, because we're doing this on Thursday, and it airs on Saturday morning for those who aren't watching us live, Collision airs tonight. So if anything else gets added, like 15 more matches to the pre-show, please note we didn't know about it because we're doing this on Thursday night live. So there you go. Just want to throw that out there now. All right, let's get to the pre-show match that is announced. I love the fact, by the way, they hyped up in weeks in advance a pre-show match. I'm not sure.
Is that a first?
That is a first for me, for any company. It is a Willow Nightingale, Mandy's favorite, and Toru Ishii versus Chris Statlander and Stokely Hathaway in a tag match. And the winning team gets to pick the stipulation for Willow Nightingale versus Chris Statlander at All Out in 2 weeks. This has got to be as simple as Willow when Ishii wins and Ishii tortures Stokely, right, Rich?
This is going to be a mollywhopping. I love the phrase mollywhopping. I think what Ishii is going to do to Stokely is a mollywhopping.
That's beautiful.
That's a great word.
Would you say Ishii would stop a mud hole in Stokely Hathaway?
I think a mud hole in the pantheon of beatdowns is like just below a mollywhopping. But just above, like so, yeah. So you'd have Mudhole, Molly Whoppin, and then whoop the tar out of him is like at the apex. Like you hit the top of the.
There you go.
Oh my God! Thank you, Rich, for just giving the clip for this big show. So I think we're all in pretty much consensus that Willow and
yeah.
Ishii are winning this thing, right?
They're not winning. They're absolutely Chris is the only one who's going to fight Hathaway.
I want to see Stokely get the hell chopped out of him. Break him in half.
Brain bust.
All right, so that is that. Let's move on to the main show. We have the Gauntlet match. Gauntlet match for a future AEW championship match. We don't know when this championship match is happening. I'm assuming All Out, but they haven't really made that clear, to be quite honest.
I think that would be the best place for it.
The participants so far are Orange Cassidy, Mark Briscoe, Kyle O'Reilly, Adam Page, and I'm not putting Evil Uno on here. I don't believe he's actually in the match. So I'm not putting it on here. But so far, I did it for people. For those who forgot, this is the match for people come out of the gauntlet match, and then the first person to get pinfall wins. No matter how
many people are in the match. So you could still be in the back, and you won't even get a chance to be
that,
in the
and the funny part is, Ospreay will not be in this match, because in the funny part, he is 2-0 in this match. So there you go. I will say that they've upped the importance of this match, though. It went from, it's just some random match that's happening, to, we're going to make an international championship match, and now it's an AEW World Championship match. So at least they've upped the importance. I think the two questions here is who wins and who is going to be the prize in this match? Because you know this is going to be the match that has the prize in it. Rich, what do you think?
Helps if I unmute. I think one of the first surprises for me is going to be if, in the main event, they slip this person in Seth Rollins style as a contender. And I think it could be Darby Allin. But Darby already has a title shot. So why would it be Darby Allin?
Isn't Darby facing the
scapegoat?
Well, he's taking on the scapegoat, but he also won the other battle royal that gives him a title shot after this.
A grand slam.
So yeah, so he's got like
double title Darby.
Title shots for days. Like, I just want to give him another one. Like, have him win one, and so that way he's just like the next 3 years where the title matches are Darby Allin versus whomever the champion is.
Trying to piss off the guys over at Brass Ring Media. Is that what you're trying to do?
Yes.
Well played, sir. Well played.
One of the persons laughing at that joke. Dad, what do you think?
I'm going to go with a surprise of Edge being in the gauntlet.
Ooh, Adam Copeland being in there would be interesting. I'm not going to lie. That would be really interesting.
I mean, I would think that if you're thinking about kind of being on the fence about retiring, you would want a shot at the title shot before you hang up your boots.
Good point. That's a good call. CJ, what do you think?
First off, glad you collected him, because I was about to go, actually, it's Adam Copeland, not Edge.
Thank you for correcting me, Sir Christian.
Thank you. Voice is perfect.
You're welcome. But I was going to say Cassidy, but I'm going to have to go with O'Reilly because
an intriguing
fact. He, by himself, as a tag wrestler, he's amazing, but as a solo, he's underrated.
Ooh.
Because when he was in NXT, he did not win anything, but he was very close to it. So I think seeing him as the champion eventually in AEW would actually be pretty good for him.
That's intriguing. I like that a lot, actually.
And does not own O'Reilly Auto Parts.
So, by the way, I just want to throw out there, when I used to regular shows here, and Kyle O'Reilly was on the show all the time, and Dak can vouch for this. Every time Kyle O'Reilly was in the ring, the people in the Milwaukee audience started saying, oh, O'Reilly. Every match for the entire match. Go on every single time.
Because of the auto car parts store. That's so why.
Ridiculous. So ridiculous. But okay. So I am, my surprise here is going to be one Ricochet.
Ooh.
And I actually see him winning this thing. I just don't know if we want to lose his first world title match. It's a lot like if you won me, Brian, like, what was it, like Leo Rush.
Yeah,
and like something like that, like people surprised like that. Maybe have him enter the match but not lose. And I can see Orange Cassidy winning it. They made a big deal out of him being the first person in this match. They made a big deal out of it. So I can almost see them being like, look, the first person in here can win the match.
Ironically, so, on like a real gauntlet match, you want to be number one.
Yeah,
number
exactly. Two. And 100% right.
Here's a question. Where the hell is Powerhouse Hobbs?
Injured.
Somewhere.
Injured. He's injured. He got hurt. He got really hurt really bad. I think it was that collision or something.
Yeah, I just want to, you know.
He's in the Derek Zoolander school for kids who can't read good.
Oh, my God.
I forgot that Christian's not used to Rich's sense of humor, and I love it.
Yeah.
I love it. I know. Yep, you know what? Round of applause. Love the sense of humor. Love it.
Oh, God.
I respect you already. Got my respect already. It's been 30 minutes.
I think we should throw out Wardlow's name in there and see what happens.
Oh, I was actually about to mention him, too.
Well, Wardlow, it's got to be relevant once in a while. Be helpful for his career. Be relevant here and there.
We know that Adam Cole can't go, so.
Well, maybe he can. We don't know.
No, he's about to come out with crutches again. He's about to enter the ring to super kick with crutches.
Adam!
All right, let's move on, because that was that whole storyline was like crushed on Wednesday night, by the way. The whole thing was crushed by Asprey. Let's move on. I'm cringing to press the next button, but I'm going to do it anyway. God. It is the FCW Championship match. It is the Learning Tree. Chris Jericho with the Redwood Big Bill and the Red Apple Brian Keith defending against Hook.
What are these names? And this who named these people?
The Learning Tree did. And if Hook loses, he will not get another title shot against Chris Jericho. And as Jericho put it, he will no longer be in the Jericho Vortex. Swear to God, that's what he said. I made that up if I wanted
to. This is why I don't watch the AEW clips when it comes to this man.
Oh my Lord, I hate this gimmick. I know Dallo's making fun of it. I hate this gimmick so much. But Mandy loves him. The Learning Tree. So there you go.
The Redwood and the Bad Apple.
It's all tree puns. All tree puns.
did he just look up the first tree
part
pun?
My favorite part about Brian Keith, though, is he doesn't say anything. Until the end, we just call somebody a bitch or send you unrespect to Jericho. That's all he said. It's absolutely hysterical.
What is this, Okada?
It's absolutely hysterical. I love it. It makes me laugh. The only part of the gimmick that makes me chuckle. I think I'm going to go first here. This is as simple as Hook wins, and Taz interferes and helps Hook win. Despite him saying on commentary that he didn't need my help, I think Jericho's going to piss him off to the point where he's going to get off commentary, interfere, and Hook and him are going to celebrate, and then Nigel's going to come out and finish the show. That's what I think it's going to happen.
Or, like you said, I'm going to add on to that. Taz either gets rid of Brian Keith or Big Bill.
Yes. Well, in some variation, I just think Taz and the match is going to end with Taz and Hook celebrating with the title. That should go back in Taz's mantle and move on with our lives. And that's how it's going to end. Rich, what do you think?
I think it would be great for them to just, like you said, win it, retire it, and tell Hook it's time for him to win something that isn't tied to the family.
Yeah, I think he should go after like the TNT Championship or something like that now. I think he's ready, honestly, or whatever. Well, trust me, we'll get to more belts later. There's enough belts to go around. On Dad, what do you think?
I'm going to go, with Hook winning, but I think someone besides Taz is going to help him. I'm going to say Brian Cage is going to come out and also assist and help him.
Random pull.
Because wasn't he part of that group?
Team Taz back in the
day. Right.
But isn't he part of like some weird faction?
Factory?
No,
not Factory.
No, Team Taz. It was Team Taz.
I don't know. What is he part of
that? I don't have a clue anymore. He's on some weird faction that's usually a Ring of Honor television that really exists.
So
who knows?
So, I mean, I would see Brian Cage coming out and helping along with Taz.
I don't know. I don't.
That would be a big FU to the Learning Tree. Hi, guys!
I could see Ricky Stark, maybe, because Hook was the one who beat him.
True.
Ricky Starks could be the respect, because he did beat him.
Yes, Ricky Starks.
That's an intriguing. Now, that's an intriguing one, but they were aligned by them. By the way, I do find it funny that 2 years in a row at All In, Hook is trying to get back the FCW Championship. This is 2 years in a row. Because last year, I think it was Jack Perry in the pre-show, and now I think it's Jericho.
So is Ricky Stark still employed with the AEW, or is he floating around?
Nobody seems to know.
He knows it's Ricky Stark.
Maybe Ricky Stark might not even know. Who knows? So, all right, let's move on. We have the London ladder match for the AEW Trios World Trios Championship. And I'm going to, before I put this up, there is a spoiler here for a collision on Saturday night. Most people don't watch it anyway, so I'm just throwing it out there. But if you do watch Collision, fast forward to the show, or it is like, I don't know, you're watching it live. I'm sorry. I don't really care. I'm still spoiling it. So here's the match on the bottom screen, because there's so many people in here, I had to put it on the bottom. We have the Patriarchy. It is Christian Cage, Nick Killswitch, and Nick Wayne with co-champion Mother Wayne versus the Bang Bang Gang, Rock Hard, Juice Robinson, and the Guns, versus the House of Black, Malachi Black, Brody King, and Brady Matthews, versus Pac and the Blackpool Combat Club, Claudio Castagnoli, and William Yuta, for some reason. Why? I have no idea, except to get Pac on this show.
Blackpool Combat Club.
Why we did not have Claudio versus Okada in a rematch on this show, I will never know. But we're not. So,
is John Moxley kind of like...
He's on vacation. He's on vacation. Let him have vacation for a change.
He's like in a secret hiding place for vacation.
He's on vacation, enjoying time with his daughter. Let him enjoy his time with his daughter.
That's the way it should be.
So, I'm not gonna bullshit here. Most of Collision I watch high, so I don't 100% know what's going on in the next show. Even if we watch it this past Saturday, with the first show we actually missed in a while because we were in New York, and we had we were out on Saturday night, so we didn't see the show. But I just muted out Dad because he's having a coughing attack, so I muted him out. So I'm going to go around here. I really enjoy the patriarchy as a whole. I love it. Christian Cage gave one of the belts to Mother Wayne. I'm not gonna lie, I openly laughed at that. I openly laughed
at that. So but, you'll see Mother Wayne climb the ladder instead of everyone.
No, Chris wants you to do all the work, and the Mother Wayne will still get the belt back. That's how this is going to work. That's how it'll work. I don't see the Patriarchy losing the belt. There's really no reason to take the belt off them. It's the only reason this match is here, to get 87 people on the card. Rich, are you agreeing?
Yeah, I think this is one of those atta boy, atta gal, especially for Christian Cage, who's been the absolute underground MVP for a lot of what they have to do on television the last few months. So this makes sense. I want the ECW-esque witness the night Mother Wayne fought atop Wembley Arena, but you know, I won't get it.
I mean, he also hates everyone's dad.
So. Yes, that's true. No, he wants to be everybody's dad, and if your dad's dead, I'm going to talk to you about it. That's what it is. Oh, unless you're Kip Sabian, then fuck your dad. That's what I learned. I learned on a collision a couple weeks ago. Well, Nick Wayne actually said, "I don't care about your dead dad" to him. That actually happened. That collision a couple weeks ago.
What kind of piece later? I don't give a damn about your kids.
I couldn't believe it. I was like, "Wow, that actually happened."
If Christian Cage wants to be everyone's father, is he prepared to pay the back child support he owes everybody?
Oh my God,
he's not Nick Cannon.
Oh,
listen, hold up. I just gotta defend Nick Cannon real quick, because as we are aware on Twitter, Nick Cannon is the only thing keeping the Anoa'i family from running over wrestling as it stands, but specifically Rikishi, because all of his kids look like they could murder someone.
You're not wrong. Yeah. So Christian, officially pick, what are you picking here?
The patriarchy, because it's just, there's no reason to take them off. And so it will be your winners, Christian Cage, the father, the prodigy, Nick Wayne, and Mother Wayne.
Mother Wayne, yeah. And Killswitch in the background for some reason.
Killswitch.
For some reason.
Just there.
Move on to a match that I should care about more, but I really don't, but I should. It is the AEW World Tag Team Championship. It is the Young Bucks taking on FTR versus the Acclaimed in a triple threat tag match. I should really care about this match a hell of a lot more than I do. I'm almost afraid this might be my bathroom match on the show, but I just don't care. I don't care at all. And I should, but I don't. Rich, what do you think?
I do.
So this is what happens when everyone knows about your PTO at work, and that this is like the one day you can show up a month. And that's really what's happened. You know, you had the Young Bucks, a team that's just fantastic, historically one of the best in the business. But at this point, they're counting their days. They're getting paid quite well to count those days. And as a result, the FTR and Acclaimed have been picking up the pieces. And I don't know if it's enough. FTR, I joke with my buddy Chris. It's funny to me. FTR last night did the Powerplex. And to have AEW as the rival, like, upstart promotion, glorifying, which, like, I'm one of three people that love Power and Glory as a tag team. They were not a good team. I accept that through therapy. But, like, it took years of work. I had to do the work, Blake. Like, I had to do the work. Oh,
love
my guy. Let's go.
Was it the same therapist that Paul Roma went to?
Oh, my God.
Sorry. So I'm going to go out of the three of them. Oh, man. If it was, that would have been amazing. I think the Bucks are going to lose, and I think they're going to lose to the Acclaimed, because I think FTR is going to get hosed in some form or fashion. And I think there's a heel turn in the Acclaimed if they want to do it.
I can see that. I can totally see the Acclaimed. Or Max Caster turning heel. Anthony Bowens is randomly for no reason whatsoever. Did you know Max Caster is the best wrestler alive? I'm not sure if anyone knew that yet, that he's the best wrestler alive.
But he is?
Apparently, according to him, he is the best wrestler alive.
We have the best wrestler alive and a great wrestler who's gay.
Yes. Well, the best wrestler alive according to his Instagram. That's what it is.
Not bad. And Daddy Ass.
And Daddy Ass. Yes. Daddy Ass is also out there. For some reason.
Can he be the sauciest wrestler alive? But then there's Hot Sauce Tracy Williams. I don't know.
Oh, who? Fair enough. I'll give
he's you the ring of honor.
Who?
Hot Sauce Tracy Williams. Exactly. Christian, what do you think?
I don't want the Young Bucks to win.
Well, they're champions currently, that am
I don't want them to retain. So please, I don't really care who wins, just not the Matt and Nick. Sorry. Matthew and Nicholas. My mistake. I want to get fired. My bad.
You're gonna get fined.
James.
The Bucks of Young.
The Bucks of Young.
So I don't. I either want FTR or the Acclaimed. Either one, I'm happy with.
By the way, the sun is going on here, and it's getting really dark here from the light on in the room we're in.
You can tell because my background is
speaking. So, Daddy, you're the one here that's actually fully interested in this match. So go ahead.
I got the Acclaimed coming on top, but only the Acclaimed, if you've noticed with their promos and everything, have gotten a little bit more edgier, which they're getting that mean streak. They're hungry and they want this, and I think it would be a good change, because if you notice with Daddy Ass, the two words coming back are suck it. So I think we're looking for a darker, edgier Acclaimed, and I think this is what they need.
How is that dark and edgier?
Because before they were more like happy go lucky and the scissor and everything, and I think
you're doing the suck it thing since the beginning of the Acclaimed with him.
I think they're tired of it and they're looking for a change, and this would be the perfect time to do it.
The irony is, if you turn on Billy Gunn, is that really a heel turn?
Well, I'm not saying that you turn on Billy Gunn. I'm saying that the team itself becomes a little bit more edgier and darker and meaner and hungrier.
Cut things that are funny. Why make the fan maybe a fan favorite again? Because the fans don't even know how to do with him right now because they're not even funny. Because
I think they're gonna drop the scissor gimmick and they're gonna go with something else.
Scissor gimmick and drop all the money they're currently making. That's what you're doing there. So all right, let's move on to Dad's favorite match of the entire card. It is the TBS championship match. It is Mercedes.
Oh my god.
Miss CD Ho herself with Camille versus Dr. Britt Baker. DMD. Let's go around here. Christian, what do you think? We're going to save Dad for last on this one on purpose. So, Christian, you first.
Please. Britt Baker, please.
Britt, okay.
No, we don't need... What's her? How do you say her name?
Mercedes Monet.
Monet of Mercedes, okay.
Well, it's really money. I just don't ever say it that way. So, I'm not a black woman. I'm not saying money. It's not happening. So
we have a woman who's a car, and versus a doctor. So I think the doctor would win.
That was the weirdest logic I've ever heard.
if we go with Rocky.
No.
The doctor beats car because car has no teeth. Dr. DeBrad.
What?
Dr.
What the fuck kind of logic is that? I don't even know what I feel about that logic.
So yeah, Britt Baker's winning.
Oh my god. Rich, can you give me a favor? I'm going to do this. Can you do that dance step, please? Thank you. No, Rich, your thoughts on the match.
Oh, I was gonna say, you can't listen. This Mercedes is undefeated with that dance. That's like the one dance she does. And then she'll add the twist move. I will not do that because my son's going to be embarrassed enough whenever you put that clip up. it's just going to be like, he's going to be like, I don't know this man. Unfollow. Do not tag me. But yeah, I think this is a good match. I think Mercedes will retain by way of Camille interference. I think there's more to this story. I think they could have another match in them. And I think Britt's done a good job in her return at showing why she was the anchor of AEW before all of these women arrived, and then she mysteriously left for like a year and a half.
At least she has a reason why she was gone for a year and a half. At least she explained it. I hear that much. One thing I will throw out there is I think this might be, if they don't do some random match where Saraya comes down to an open challenge, I can see this being the match that Jamie Hayter comes back afterwards to help Britt against Monet and Camille after the match is over. I could totally see that happening. And you could do a tag match on Dynamite or on Collision. You'd be able to have a Collision ratings. Or do it all out instead of having another title defense. I can totally see them doing that. So I see Mercedes Monet retaining. And Jamie Hayter coming out and saving Britt Baker. I'm dead. Go ahead. Your favorite match in the world. Go.
Well, going off of Britt Baker's shoot speech, which was from the heart and true, that she's right. Mercedes is going to use this as a stepping stone to get back in WWE. So she's not going to be here for the long haul. And the other thing is, why would WWE
Mark
take back
is going off on a tangent.
Talent.
Uh-oh, Mark is going off on a tangent.
Is not polished, is not seasoned, but all it is about the bling, bling, money, 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 green.
Ooh, seasoning.
Okay, so here's my thing. Mercedes Moniz, go bye-bye. Britt Baker, DMD, has the belt. And that's end of story. And then she can kick Mercedes to the curb so she can be a madam for real, because that's what she's acting like, a madam from the streets. So you might as well be one in real life.
What is going on? Are you okay?
Yeah, I'm fine.
Oh, Mark is going off on a tangent.
Rich, he's done. He's done.
No.
I thought I hit a wrong button because I was like, why? Oh, no. Like, I didn't know there was a Mark alarm. Like, what has happened?
Uh-oh. Mark is going off on a tangent.
But yeah.
See, here's my plan. Mercedes goes back to WWE. You feed her to Jade Cargill. She smashes her. End of story. Gone.
I'm moving on. Moving on. Oh, wait, so that means Britt's winning? You never said that. Is Britt winning?
Yes, Britt's winning.
Okay.
In his eyes, he just wants anyone to win besides
I wanted to clarify what the hell happened here. All right, let's move on. We have a coffin match. First one who dies wins. It is a TV championship. It is the scapegoat, Jack Perry, who apparently made his own belt on Saturday's show. Didn't see it. I wasn't watching it this week. Versus Darby Allin, the man who refuses to die. Apparently Darby Allin undefeated in coffin matches going into this. Did not realize that until earlier today. Darby Allin's title match, an actual world title match in like a month. There was no reason to win this match at all. But the question I have, does the coffin get lit on fire? Rich?
When does the coffin get on fire is my question. Between the two of them, I think they both might wind up in a flaming coffin, and then one of them emerges, and I'm going to just put my money on Darby.
Fair enough.
What kind of a horror movie?
I mean, Jack Perry got blew on fire the first time, so I think it's only fair if Darby gets fired the second time.
All I'm saying is if either of them do die, I think the winner should be one of the announcers. So I think the winner should be either the ref. I think the ref should win, actually.
Oh, the ref should win.
Whoever the ref is should be the new TNT champion.
So, all right.
And he has to count his own pins.
So who's actually winning?
Nigel?
Wait, what?
No, Nigel. He's that.
No.
So who's actually winning that?
I'm going to have to go with, even though I like Darby, Jack Perry. Because he just won it, and there's no reason to have Darby win it right away as he.
Yeah, I don't see Jack losing. He needs this belt to stay relevant right now. I think we always joke about there's a lot of belts in AEW, but the TNT Championship actually has always meant something, and him holding the belt actually means something for him. So there's really no reason to take the belt off of him. Dad, what do you think?
So, am I to assume that this is like an anything goes match?
Well, the coffin match. I'm going to assume there's no rules.
So are we using fake glass or real glass? Oh, I'm sorry. Did we say that out loud? I'm sorry.
Zach doesn't like using fake glass. We all know.
I'm sorry. I mean, the ones that have been
really beautiful.
I'm going with Darby only because
for some reason
I think Darby's gonna pull out a flamethrower somewhere from under the ring and light the coffin on fire.
Tensi on the bottom. He's going to lit on fire.
He's going to pull it out of his ass, and he's going to light someone on fire.
Literally,
anyone want some more?
Are we lighting? Who's asked for lighting on fire?
No, he's going to.
Want some more? Light it up.
All right. We go from somebody dying to someone actually maybe dying to somebody metaphorically dying. AEW Women's Championship match. It is timeless. Tony Storm versus the Glamour, Mariah May. I have no clue what the Glamour means, but it's what it is. I think since it is a question of they want to say Mariah May's hot, so this pulls her the Glamour. I'm not going to lie. This is going to be, I'm looking forward to this match a lot. I've been looking forward to this match. And I have, there's no reason you do this match and not have Mariah May win. You set this up for almost a year now. It's got to be Mariah May winning and then Tony getting her rematch with All Out. So that's where I'm going with this. I don't know what's going on in Christian's window right now. Rich, what do you think?
I think, especially after listening to Tony on the media scrum, he's very excited about the culmination of All About Eve with this match. I think Mariah is going to win and may do it. I'm thinking there's no right mind that one should turn Mina Shirakawa heel, but I think if they're going to do it, this would be the time to do it as the maybe unwitting or unenthusiastic heel. Like, she's doing it just because she loves Mariah. I think that's where we're going to go, but I do think it's Tony's time to kind of fade out and have to seek revenge on this understudy.
Yeah, what do you think?
Unfortunately, I'm going to have to say that Mariah is going to get the belt, but instead of Ishikawa kind of turning a play, I was thinking, what if Luther gets involved and turns on her?
I don't know. I see Luther interfering. I just don't see a reason why he would turn on Tony after Mariah literally bloodied him. I don't see it happening.
Well, because he's not happy with her because he's not getting recognized for helping her.
She always recognized him. That doesn't make any sense. It does.
I mean, it's all about Mariah, and he is like an afterthought. So now the jealousy.
Why would he turn on? So you're saying he turns on Mariah or Tony? Who's he turning on?
He's gonna turn on Tony and help Mariah win.
You confused me with your explanation there for a second. Yeah.
No, he's gonna turn on Tony and he's gonna help Mariah win. Okay. It's gonna come down to the silver platter on the head.
Sure. What the? This is for Tony.
Timeless to me.
So let's move on. We have the AEW Amera International Championship match. It is MJF taking on Will Ospreay. They had a 59-minute fucking classic on Dynamite. And now here we are. We have this match happening. It is the rematch, like I said, for the AEW Amera International Championship. Simple as Rich, what do you think is going to happen here? Is it as simple as Will Ospreay wins and he brings back the Intercontinental Championship, or some way MJF going to pull off winning, kicking out of the Tiger Driver and actually winning this title and most of the building riding?
No, this is the time for all day Ospreay. Hit the Tiger Driver. He got the Bryan Danielson approval to use it last night. Let him win in front of his family, have his son come in the ring and kick the corpse of MJF afterward and just keep it moving.
I will say that was one of the best promos I've ever seen from Ospreay. That was fantastic. Christian, what are you going to say? I don't know, but we're going to ask for you for it. Just talk.
No, I'm going to agree. Yeah. I'm agreeing with you on that one. Will Ospreay should win. I mean, he even got the approval of Bryan Danielson. And if you got that approval, then I think definitely go for it. But I do have to agree. At this point, you should get the flamethrower from Darby and Jack and just light it on fire as well. Just light him on fire.
All in fire.
Kill him.
All in, colon, fire. That's the name of our Twitter.
All in on fire.
Hot dogs and ham and s'mores. Yeah, that's it.
Yeah. Okay, Dad, what do you think?
It's Ospreay's time. And I want to see the crowd reaction when he wins the belt, because I think the crowd is going to go nuts. It's going to be phenomenal. And when his wife and son come into the ring, it's going to be that very emotional moment that everyone's looking for and culmination to this. And this is just a starting for Ospreay to go on to other belts and other titles. And hopefully once he gets his belt, he'll change it back and not the American International House of Pancakes title or whatever you want to call it.
I like that one. American International House of Pancakes. That's something CJ's phone fell right next to me. He's trying to mess around with his stuffy and he accidentally, right there, I mean, his Squishmallow over here, and he accidentally knocked over his phone right next to me. So, all right. Let's move on to our main event. It is the big match, and it is the actually being promoted as this, so I have the right to do this.
It's the final countdown.
the AEW World Heavyweight Championship versus career. Stuart Strickland defending against Bryan Danielson. Maybe his first career. I've lost track of the storyline at this point. I hope that's what the storyline is. But they are calling it the final countdown, so I'm assuming that's what we're doing. And I swear to God, if they didn't come out to the final countdown, I'm going to be very disappointed.
I mean, if he doesn't, I think that's just going to be one of the most disappointing things.
I mean, if you promote it as the final countdown, you better come out with music.
He comes out with the most random theme song.
I mean, like...
Tony can pay for it. He's got the bills.
What was that?
Tony's got the bills. He can pay for the music.
I know it's expensive as hell, but come on. It's the biggest show of the year, and this could be his last match, so
yeah,
go for it. Okay, so I'm mixed here. This match is very mixed to me. I've gone back and forth with this one for a couple of weeks, so I'm not 100% sure to go. So, Christian, I'm going to start with you. Is he retiring, or is he winning the title?
I don't actually know. I see Swerve winning because of how this is built up. But I see Brian also winning, keeping his career intact for how long now?
25 years. Something like that.
They're keeping his 25-year career
put intact. I think this is like his second retirement now, if it actually is his second
say.
Retirement.
I was about to say, if he does retire, he's probably going to come back eventually.
I'd wear a mask in Mexico, as Swerve said.
Looking for orphans.
But so officially, what are you picking?
I'm going to have to go with Strickland of Swerve.
I love how these are your jokes now. These are your
but,
jokes.
But maybe Brian Danielson can come back as, get this, Daniel Bryan.
I think it's owned. I think it's somebody, some other company owns that.
My bad.
I mean, they're being really good about things, but I don't think that one's going to pass.
Yeah, my bad.
Copyright infringement.
Strickland of Swerve with Nana Prince dancing in the background.
Okay, we got your joke. Rich, what do you think?
Well, this is like one of the saddest main events I can think of because it's like if Danielson wins, everyone's happy that he beat the Swerve guy that's so mean, etc. But if he loses, he goes home to his son and daughter and gets to be a father? Like, there's like, this is like a Sophie's Choice situation. It's like, oh yeah, like, man, it really stinks that this guy gets to be a great dad. Like, really sad that, the guy who had to retire because of neck injuries and concussions has to go home and not get hurt. Like, it throws me off. So, the only thing that, I mentioned this to Wade when we talked about this pay-per-view, I think the fact that when Tony Khan talked about his champions, he mentioned how he wanted a certain group of people. Like, he wanted Jericho to be the first champion. He wanted Kenny to be a champion. He knew Hangman would be a champion. If you have a wrestling promotion and you've had CM Punk, Samoa Joe, and Kenny Omega as your champion, you for darn sure want in the annals of your history Bryan Danielson to have been a champion. So I think he does win. I think Danielson wins to the chagrin of Birdie and their son. And then loses it subsequently without the retirement on the line at Wrestle Dream to Darby Allin.
Okay.
Darby's back.
Do not worry, I'm not laughing at you. That was a great. That was
Bottom third, and he did this season coming up.
That was a great point you made there.
So, okay, Dad, what do you think that happened here?
Well, a lot of people brought out the fucking American Dragon. And it showed last night, and he's fired up, he's feisty, and this is great. This is what we want. This is what everybody wanted and wants to see. So I want him to kick Swerve's ass. I want him to take the belt. I want him to hold it high, dance around with it, with everyone doing the yes chant, and basically kick his body out of the ring. And just watch it just be lifeless and not moving.
So, I'm like I said earlier, I'm torn. Much like Rich was with the fantastic logic of, is he going to be a dad or is he going to win the AEW championship? It's fantastic logic, which is why it's on the bottom scroll now.
Greatest logic ever.
My whole thing here is, this. You know what threw me was last Wednesday night when they played that video to Green Day. That's what threw me. Because I was all on board with Bryan Danielson winning the title. Until they play that video. And you don't do that video if he's not losing this match. That's just my personal opinion. You don't do that. You don't pay Green Day for that song. It's just not for a reason. You just don't do it. So with that being said, I see Swerve taking the title, and then we have a nice farewell. But one thing I will say, you better give them the time, him the time to give a good farewell speech, like you didn't give the time to Sting back in March. That's all I know. That's all I'm saying that right now.
Because my thing is, he wins the belt, and then later on when he decides the date to retire, he surrenders the belt, and you have a tournament, which gives Will Ospreay a chance to be the main man.
He has to lose. He's too old school to not lose, go out with it on his back. He's too old school like that. So he's going to have to lose the title eventually.
But all else fails, it's going to be one hell of a match.
Yeah, that's for sure.
The only thing that I would see, as long as he gains the respect of Swerve Strickland at the end of the match, then, you know, everything will fall into place.
Yeah. All right.
See a handshake.
Well, that is that. That is our show. That is it's all in. So let's actually wrap things up here. Sal's not here. I have to do this. Wait, one button. Here it is. Sorry, Sal wasn't here, so I threw me off. Let's do this. Bring this up. Oh, wrong one. That's Rich's. This is ours. That's ours.
Hey.
And let's hit this.
Thank you so very much.
That was the wrong button. Sorry about that. Live, this is live.
For more information on our show, including where you can find us on social media or watch the show on YouTube, go to theblakeandsalshow.com. Don't forget to comment or leave a rating and review, and we will read it on the show.
All right, we're going to close here with as CJ here is messing with the screen here. There you go. Turn that off. Is that better? Is that better for you, CJ? Is that better? So we're going to close the show, actually, with a little bit of I've been listening to a lot of Phineas and Ferb lately because Master Comic Con is going to have a lot of Phineas and Ferb presentations. I'm listening to a lot of Phineas and Ferb lately. I wanted to close this show with Someone Belongs to You for the Phineas and Ferb soundtrack, just because I can, for no reason. Why not, right?
Yeah, why not?
So we obviously had Sal sign off already. He's already gone. Dad, why don't you do your thing and go for it.
Hey. If you guys want to go to any professional wrestling organization show for 2.5 hours and be amazed on what they can do as far as how they speak into the mic, do the promos, the moves, the signatures, continue the whole shebang to basically make you feel happy at the end of the show. So,
oh God, there's a camera.
What? There's no air raid siren? Come on, guys. Thank you. Hey, so yeah, go see the matches. Have fun. Have a good time. That's what it's all about, to be entertained.
Okay, there you go. Oh, man, that was too simple sometimes. It really is.
Need air raid siren on your soundboard.
Oh, God, man. So, Rich, why don't you do one more time, get your plugs in, go.
Well, as always, thank you guys for having me on. This was fun. Cristian, you rock. As always, you can follow me on Twitter at Rich_Fann, F-A-N-N. You can follow me at the Pro Wrestling Torch with the Everything Podcast, the Deep Dive with Rich Fann, and then over at Post Wrestling, you can always see me with a little MCU later.
There you go.
Love this guy.
There you go. Yeah, this is a lot of fun. As always, Rich, thank you so much. As always, you're always welcome back. Anything, anytime. This is fantastic. Especially since every time you come here, it's like we have a new format, or I have new toys to play with over here. Every time you come on the show. So
it's been fun.
So one quick question for Rich. Have you seen the trailer for Brave New World Captain America?
Yes.
I think everybody has.
What did you think of it?
Okay.
Greatly enjoyed it. I saw it before Deadpool 3. Nothing made me happier than seeing Harrison Ford, just Harrison Fording it up on the screen.
All right. Beautiful word.
All right.
Fabulous words.
I got to get through my plug here. Next week, we're going to have two shows. Friday, we're going to have the recap. This is a fun episode to record. The recap of Fan Expo Chicago. That was a clusterfuck recording. So listen to that next Friday. And next Saturday, will be me and Mandy recapping our trip to New York City over on Fucking Politics. Week after our next live show, join us on September 5th at 2 p.m. Eastern Time, 1 p.m. Central Time, with special guest John Parker from Batman. We're going to be previewing All Out and, of course, looking back to All In. On that wonderful note, thank you all for listening as all. Thank you, Rich, and thank you, Christopher, for coming on the show. Sal, I hope you feel better. Thank you all for listening to the live show. We'll see you in a couple of weeks. Have a good day, everybody.
Bye.
See you guys. We love you. Hey, Sal, get better soon.
Friend says bye.
Baby, baby, baby. Summer belongs to you. Summer belongs to you.
Thank you so very much. Goodbye. Mwah. And good night.
Bye-bye, bitch.